Hi everyone, and welcome back to our procurement and finance coffee break. I'm Claire, your finance transformation expert.
And apparently I'm Richard, the procurement guy, which I've only just noticed. So I do procurement.
Randomly. Yeah, procurement dude.
Procurement dude. Never been called a dude, never will be called a dude.
You don't look like a dude, to be honest, in your tweed jacket.
I'm allowed.
You look more like a professor than a dude, to be honest.
I think I kind of prefer that.
Yeah, okay, right. So today we're diving into future trends in forecasting for procurement and finance teams.
Cool.
I think, you know, we've talked about data in the past.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And, you know, if you as a finance function or indeed a procurement function want to really add value to your business, the key is to be able to provide accurate forecasts and accurate financial information. It links to the quality of your data, quality of systems, and access to real-time data.
Yeah.
But so Richard, it guides our decision making and strategy for procurement in particular. It helps us plan our sourcing and supply chain needs effectively. So let's talk tech. How do you see technology influencing the future of forecasting?
All right. Well, I'm just going to bring it back a step first, which is we are terrible at forecasting. Everybody's terrible at forecasting. You know, I'm sure there are lots of automotive companies out there that are brilliant at forecasting, but again, I'm going to make a sweeping generalization. You know, if I think of the number of times where, you know, you are running some kind of RFP with suppliers to go and get laptops, and the suppliers come back to you and say, well, give us a forecast of how many laptops you're going to need over the next year, 2 years, 3 years, because we can give you a different pricing structure. And the answer is And, you know, that should be the simplest thing because, you know, we know how many employees we've got or we might have. We know how long a laptop lasts. We could do a pretty simple sum that says, right, we need 1,000 and we're going to need 200 new ones every year. I mean, that's forecasting in sim, and we just don't do it. And the tragedy is because we don't do it, we miss out on value. And we miss out on value, not just in terms of price, but also in terms of being able to get a commitment from the supplier that says, right, you know, this isn't just a one-off order for a volume. This actually could be a rolling requirement for, you know, a larger thing going forward. So forecasting is critical. It's also really hard. And the reason it's hard is for all the reasons that, you know, we find any kind of, predicting the future difficult, which is today's data isn't reliable. We haven't got real-time data. We have got different business units, different geographies, different IT systems, which we can't interrogate. And we've got that natural human reluctance from stakeholders to say, well, this is what I need today, and this is what I think I'm going to need in the future. Because, you know, quite rightly, they're under pressure with their own budgets. They don't want to say something that's wrong, and they're probably going to be conservative. So, to answer your question, in that context, the only way we're going to fix it is by using tech. And it's the same things that we've been talking about. It's AI. It is about analytics. It's about automation. And why those three things? Because the ability of tech to look at your past buying patterns, to identify trends and then suggest to you, you know, this is what we think you're going to need in the future, coupled with looking at the outside world to see what the trends are in whatever it is you're procuring, not just pricing, but availability or technology development. Technology can say, right, this is what we think your demand might be, high and low band. This is where we recommend you pitch in the middle, and you can then have a really good conversation. But you need tech to do that. And in fact, you know, in the procurement space, you've got, you know, companies like Archestro, for example, that are actively moving into predictive procurement. So looking at how you can accelerate the way that you run, you know, commercial RFX out to suppliers, where you say to them, right, this is what I need, these are the volumes, this is what I think the pricing is, so you know, let's just narrow down quickly on a structured deal to match it.
Mm.
And that's where the power comes. So forecasting is essential. We're bad at it. Tech is going to help. Your tech is going to be a look at what we've already done.
Yeah.
And, you know, look at what's going on.
Yeah. Okay. Cool. And now if we think about, you know, if we start using these advanced technologies, we are going to have challenges. And we've already said many, many times, historic data is key.
Yeah,
And having integrated systems is also key.
Yep.
And if you don't have integrated systems, perhaps going back to our last vlog, having some sort of interim solution of RPA to be able to convert data in one format to another format. So you've kind of got an automated mapping of end-to-end data. So data and integration issues will always be, you know, difficulty. It enables you to have difficulty for AI and other analytics if you don't have those, because they're essentially prerequisites. But then assuming you have those, then I think the other thing that we're kind of seeing as technology is advancing quite quickly is skills gap. You know, how many companies can say they've got skills for tomorrow when it comes to AI, for example, because most companies, and certainly small businesses, probably, you know, some of them won't have even looked at the latest AI tools. I'm speaking to someone later today who's using AI in a very innovative fashion to help them analyze mass data and prepare reports based on that mass data they receive quicker. They're not solely relying on it, they're still building in checks to check that the way the data's been summarized is correct. But I would say there isn't as many examples of companies who are like thinking, right, this is some new technology, how can I quickly leverage that and have the skills in-house to be able to do so.
I think you're right. And I think even if, you know, if you come back, even before technology, right, and you work on the basis, right, procurement, I'm going to forecast demand. So I'm going to go to my stakeholder, I'm going to say, right, how many do you think we need? And, you know, if I'm going to come up with an agreement with the supplier, the chances are it's going to have an over and under clause. So, you know, I get a price if I, you know, go past a certain volume point, I'll get a discounted price or I'll get a rebate. Good news. So if I can forecast that, I can, you know, make that attractive to the supplier. But it's a double-edged sword. If you say, well, I need 2,000 now and I think I'm going to need $250,000 this year, and the supplier gears up their team, their production to do it, and then you only actually need 10,000, don't think the supplier's going to take that on the chin. They're going to be saying, well, actually, no, the price has gone up because you were just nowhere near. And of course, in that context, it's why human nature is such that people are reluctant to commit to forecasts.
They normally do like a sort of a minimum order, and then, you know, at the end of the year, if you achieve X volume or if you buy X volume, we'll give you a volume rebate on it, don't they?
Because of that reluctance, you don't get the full value. Now, look, I'm not going to make a general sweeping statement. You know, manufacturing companies are brilliant at forecasting, you know, bills of material requirement, just-in-time manufacturing, you know, being able to look at what you're going to be doing and then scheduling everything behind it. They're brilliant. But in general, particularly in the world of indirects, we're not so hot and we're nervous to do it. So you're absolutely right. The skill set, not just to understand how technology can help, but actually to have the confidence and to understand the value of being able to do it is important as well.
Yeah. And how do you think finance and procurement teams can collaborate a little bit more to enhance forecasting accuracy? I mean, obviously, you know, AP spend is going to hit the P&L or the balance sheet.
Yep.
There's an obvious area there to think about, you know, what's the procurement budget for the year and exactly how does it link into the finance budget?
We have spoken about this so many times, but it actually just comes down to the three really big ones, which is, you know, why are we doing the procurement and finance coffee break? It's because our data is shared data.
Mm-hmm.
We should be planning stuff together and we should be talking.
Yeah.
That's it. And, you know, it's coming up with a, because there will be you know, there'll be some people who are cavaliers, some people who are conservative, but actually by sitting down procurement and finance and the stakeholder who's actually consuming the product or service we're getting, so that as a team you reach an agreed sensible position, but maybe what you think the max might be, what you think the min might be, because then if all three are aligned, it's not about blame culture, it's about being able to say, look, we actually made a sensible decision based on all the data that was available to us that aligned, you know, business performance, risk, and supplier capability, and you end up with the right thing. So yeah, so it's three: data, planning, comms.
Okay. So then if we're thinking about what skills will be essential for finance and procurement professionals in the era of advanced forecasting technology, so I think I've said many times that I'm expecting in the next few years, I'm not sure exactly when, but in the next few years, because I don't exactly know, you know, I know SAP, for example, spent billions on AI, but I don't know how advanced they are in what they're developing. But let's imagine in the next, I don't know, 2 to 5 years that AI is really embedded in SAP and some other ERP systems. I always talk about SAP because if you ever look at the Gartner's magic quadrant of ERP innovators, SAP's always up in the top right-hand corner as the innovator in ERP, and then Oracle's a bit behind, and then you've got some other systems, and then probably down here in the left-hand corner of small and not innovative is, I don't know, maybe QuickBooks or Hero or something like that, Zero, whatever it's called. Yeah, so that's why I always talk about SAP and always think about, well, what's the leading functionality that SAP has, because I always think of it as the leading edge in innovation. So I kind of imagine that in the next, I don't know, let's say 2 to 5 years, we're going to have AI heavily embedded in ERP systems. And for example, one example of that is, let's say at the moment in functionality for AR or bank recs, rather than automating a receipt from a customer or a receipt on a bank account manually, you can create rules that says if it tells me this information, allocate it to this account or allocate it to the invoice. So you can build those rules in SAP to automate it for you. But those rules are manually input, a bit like, again, a bit like if formula, if you're building in Excel, if this, do this. But I'm very much imagining quite soon AI will become heavily embedded where it's learning itself what the rules should be, suggesting additional rules. So it's not so onerous on someone to think, oh, well, what should the rules be? So if we think about that happening very soon, and that a lot of these sort of tasks that are very transactional and routine in nature become automated through embedded AI, that's sort of self-learning. What do you see as essential skills for professionals?
I think you're right. I think that that integration of AI, which we've talked about so many times, is coming, but in the meantime that doesn't change the requirement for having people who have the right analytical skills. So not just so they can look at it in the absence of AI, but when AI is making recommendations, there's still a judgment to be applied as to whether you want to accept or not accept, you know, the AI's recommendation. And, you know, it's no different to, you know, the disclaimer at the bottom of ChatGPT telling you to check the results because they're not always right. So analytical skills are important. I think tech confidence, tech savviness, so the ability to look at ever smarter tools and the recommendations they're giving you based on the data that they have access to, so that you can use your analytical skills to say, well, I can understand where it's got this and why it's telling me. And I think the last part is, you know, I put it under the heading of, you know, adaptability, but actually under adaptability I'm just going to still include that kind of networking and you know, communication, because by adaptability, what I mean is the ability of procurement, finance, and whichever internal stakeholder you are working with on your forecast, whether it's buying laptops or food or energy, because you've got to be able to look at it. And we talked about forecasting in a previous coffee break. Well, you know, the ability to forecast and the ability to adapt recommendations that are coming so that you are making decisions cognizant of risk, I think is really important.
I think something I would add to that, you know, if I was building a, you know, my own finance team or procurement team, I think what I'd be looking for in my hires, particularly in junior hires who are going to progress as this technology evolves, is people who are self-starters and curious. I wouldn't be less impressed by people who kind of like, you know, well, I'll do it this way until you train me otherwise.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, you want people who are kind of inquisitive, try to think of ways to improve things themselves, not necessarily just implement it, but just to think creatively and see what technology is available and how it could be used. Because you kind of find that if you think about, like, what we're saying is we want, you know, let's say you're presented with a forecast and it says, well, based on these assumptions that you've told me to use, here's the forecast for the next quarter within a sensitivity margin of this or whatever. And let's say you'd as part of your business processes, you train someone to check, you know, I don't know, the cash reconciled, the starting cash reconciled to the balance sheet and the bank account and, the starting AR reconciled. Yeah, yeah. You know, you performed a certain number of checks and the sales roughly, you know, agreed to the forecast. And you performed checks 1 to 5 that sort of said that this forecast that had been produced by II was a credible forecast. Mm. But if there still be like, within that, some things where you think, well, perhaps that 1 to 5 checklist doesn't capture everything, that might be not quite right. So I think it's that ability to be a bit of a self-starter and think about, like, okay, what else do I know about the business? What was going on last year? How does it compare to last year? Just think through and be more curious and more skeptical. And, you know, you know, when you provide training, you're not always going to think, well, these are the 5 things you must check.
Yeah.
So maybe, I think that self-starter and being curious and a self-learner is quite important skills.
I mean, maybe you expand it to say, well, it's not just analytical skills, and it's critical thinking skills as well. It's the ability to challenge, to think about, to challenge, and to ask whether, you know, something is reasonable. You know, it's a bit like looking at forecasting ice cream sales in the UK. It doesn't matter what the computer said, Mother Nature has got a completely different view on the matter.
Yeah.
And it's having someone who can look at the data, but look at reality and apply experience in a sensible way.
Yeah.
Because, look, a forecast isn't supposed to be a Bible. It's supposed to be a direction of travel that allows you to plan and to deliver value in whatever you're doing. So, look, great topic, great discussion. The point is, even if you're, you know, we're not suggesting you should immediately hop to some AI-driven technology with a NASA cohort of critical analytical superhumans. We're not. We're just saying, what are the steps that you could take to start to think about what's going to happen in the next 3, 6, 9, 12 months? How can you bring procurement and finance together and your wider stakeholders to do that? Because if you do it, it's going to allow you to drive value, but also make decisions and then test whether those decisions are okay.
Mm.
So